Hello, welcome to GOTO Aarhus. My name is Christian. I'm the author of the book Five Lines of Code about refactoring, and I'm here with Adam.
Hi everyone, I'm Adam Tornhill. I'm a programmer with an odd combination in my background. I have a degree in engineering and psychology. And what I do these days is pretty much to try to combine these two perspectives. I've written a couple of books about it, Your Code is CodeScene and Software Design X-Rays.
Yeah, great books also. I really wanted to talk to you about this social side of tech that I heard you talk about also, because your take on refactoring code quality and stuff is entirely new to me. At least I've never seen anyone do forensic analysis, which is, yeah, really interesting. So maybe you could start by saying something about that.
Yeah, sure. I think it's a perspective that we need to talk much more about, because one thing I kind of learned quickly is that there is so much more to code complexity than just the code itself. We have this whole social dimension, like the current team, are they familiar with the code? And to me, one of the great tragedies of software design is that the organization that builds the code, they're actually invisible in the code itself, right? We cannot pick up a piece of code and see, is this a major coordination bottleneck for 5-feature teams, or is it a module that's written by just one developer, so we have a massive key personnel dependency?
Yeah.
That dimension is simply missing.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. And there is like so much about the social part of the code. It's humans working with the code, and it's them who need to refactor it, and there are managers, and there are all of these different things. I found actually about the managers a very interesting thing when I was seeing your talk earlier, that you have this yellow, red, and green categories for code, and then you can use this to show to managers to say, look, we have all these red parts, and that's bad, we want all these green parts. What I would expect to happen in that case from the managers I've met in my career is a race to yellow. Right? They don't want to be the worst. They don't want to be green either. That seems wasteful, right? At least that's my experience.
Oh, yeah, that's interesting. You could very well be right. I think the challenge is that if you have red code and you want to move to green, it's a long, long journey, right? It's a lot of effort that goes into that. Mm-hmm. I've worked with a customer just a couple of months ago. They actually spent a year trying to improve their the health of their code. I think they managed to get it up 25%. Mm-hmm. So I don't have the absolute numbers, but what was so interesting was that they also measured the amount of unplanned work that they had.
Yeah.
And they used that as kind of a goal. Can we reduce the amount of unplanned work? And they measured something like an 80% reduction in unplanned work by doing all these refactorings.
Yeah.
So I find that really, really fascinating that code quality is something that impacts every business. And yet it's something that we kind of we underestimate the importance of it, in my opinion.
Yeah. So there's both the, underestimating what the value is, and it's been really hard for, so I go and coach teams to do it, and it's really hard to argue to the managers and to the management team in general that we need to invest more in these things. And and I had the question, how do you actually deal with people? How do you tell them that you need to implement more time for refactoring? And I just said, well, we reserve 20% of the time every Monday in particular. That's my experience is based on the DevOps handbook, where it says 20% should be used on just status quo, not even improvement. That's just what you need to stay still. Do you have any experience on that?
I do. And I think it's, I've seen it work, and I've seen a lot of organizations attempted to do things like having a technical debt budget. And I think it very much depends what you do with that time. During your talk, you pretty much used that Monday for allowing people an opportunity to develop their skills, to do self-improvements, and that's something that benefits everyone, including the code base. Mm. But I've also seen organizations where stuff like paying down technical debt was mandated from above without necessarily giving the skills and the tool set that the developers need. And what tends to happen then can be disastrous. So I've seen organizations that they run some static analysis tool, they end up with a list of 8,000 major issues. And the first thing that happens is you put a quantitative goal on it and say that, okay, over 3 months, we're going to reduce this from 8,000 issues to 5,000. Have you ever seen something like that happen too?
Well, I've seen it with warnings.
Yeah.
When you turn up warnings the first time, people are like, should we look at those?
Yeah, exactly.
Yes, of course.
Exactly. But that's my experience too. The first thing that tends to happen is that, improvement possibilities, they just get thrown out. No one even looks at them, right? Then you have warnings. Yeah. We don't have time for that. So you focus on the major issues, the really critical stuff. And even then you might have thousands of it.
Yeah.
So I think without taking this proactive approach that you're talking about, I think we're doomed. I think there's no way we're going to solve that.
Yeah, but even talking when we're talking about the social side of refactoring and stuff, also having just a number show up that's 5,000 problems or something, right? Or 99 plus or whatever. Whenever it gets too big, humans are like, oh, I can't, I'm not going to deal with this. It's too many. Why even start? Because it's not going to make an impact. And that sort of sets us further back, right? Because then you just turn off the warnings, or you annotate your code to just not do those types of warnings, or we don't use that, or throw out tools. I've seen people just stop using tools because they gave too many warnings and errors.
It's yeah, exactly. It's very common. It's very much, I mean, living with that amount of issues, it's very much like a broken window, right? So I always kind of compare it to, you know, going from 5,000 issues to 3,000 or something like that. It's very much like choosing to jump from the third instead of the fifth floor, right?
Yeah.
Most likely none of them is a good idea.
Yeah.
And the reason I say this is because taking a purely quantitative view like that, you lack the most important thing, and that's the business impact, right? So it's maybe it's not, maybe you don't have to fix all 5,000 issues. Mm-hmm. Maybe you just have to fix five of them. But there's no way of knowing, but right, because if you just look at the code, you get, in my opinion, a very limited perspective, because the code itself cannot tell you anything about the interest rate or the business impact.
Yeah. For me, I've had situations where one of the warnings actually turned out to be hiding a much worse issue, but because we weren't looking into warnings at the time, we would just have that go unnoticed, and we had this huge bug. And when we started looking at the warnings, we found errors afterwards, which was just amazing. And so I've started treating all warnings as if it's the worst error I can have, because it might be hiding something really important. They take warning signs really, really seriously. I'm really scared of that.
Yeah, it's virtually free to treat warnings as errors if you do it early on, right?
Yeah.
And for all the new code you write, definitely. And then gradually, what do you do with existing code? Do you gradually try to enable warnings there, or?
Yes, I would say, well, I actually make an error budget, and then I have the trend go down. As you said, it's more important that we're actually doing something to get it down and stopping the bleed so that it doesn't grow, at least. And then over time, you know, you shave off a little. And also, I'm very big, again, on the human side, so I make sure to celebrate a lot of cake or drinks or whatever your fancy is. Like, celebrate whenever something has gone right, even slightly. And also celebrate when something's gone wrong, right?
I mean,
so long as you learned something, I think it's really important.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that.
You actually have a code base because you have a product company.
I do. I do indeed have a code base.
How do you approach refactoring in CodeScene?
So CodeScene is fascinating because we have been using CodeScene on CodeScene from day one.
Mm-hmm.
It's multiple reasons. First of all, I'm a big fan of eating our own dog food. I think that's very important. And being software developers ourselves and making tools for other software people, we are pretty much in the target audience. So it kind of helps, and I think this is very much underestimated. I mean, I used to be a consultant back in the day, and one thing I always found missing was that my onboarding when I got to a new client was very much focused on the tech, mm-hmm. and very little on the actual problem domain.
Yeah.
And my experience is that the more we understand of the problem domain, the better we can optimize what we do.
Yeah.
So I think that's really important. That's why everyone at CodeScene uses CodeScene. The second reason is that we're a pretty small company. So we're our competitors. They might have like 10 times the engineering department that we do. So it's very clear that we cannot compete by doing the same thing as they do, right? So for us as a small company, we simply cannot afford much technical debt.
Yeah.
So we need to keep a really, really healthy code base.
So it's all green? No red?
No red, mm-hmm. a few yellow dots.
Yeah.
But I think as long as we're aware of where they are, and as long as they are stable and well understood, then we can live with that, right? And once we get to that area, then we make sure to not make it worse. I think that's my number zero rule for managing technical debt. No matter where you start from, don't make it worse.
Yeah.
If you do that, then you're already doing better than, I would say, 95% of all companies.
How do you budget for refactoring and improvement in general?
We don't. We don't.
People just do them automatically?
People do it automatically. And it works pretty well. I mean, we're a small team, and we have this culture where we really value healthy code. And but we actually started to think about that a while ago, that I like what you said, that you know, you celebrated the wins, even if it just meant that something broke and we learned something. Right? Yeah. I think that's really important. So one thing we started to work on a couple of months ago was that can we kind of identify all the successful refactorings in a code base and put them up there on the CodeScene dashboard? Because I think there's so much we can learn from each other. So I'm a big fan of refactoring. I'm a big fan of the refactoring books that you mentioned in your talk. I also think that there's value in having refactoring examples from our own code, because it's code written by someone on our team, right?
Yeah.
So it's very likely that it's in the same domain, but it's also in the same style that we write code ourselves.
Yeah.
So that has been an interesting experiment as well.
Yeah. And you said, you mentioned to me beforehand that it's a very functional code base, or like Clojure, right?
Yeah, it's Clojure.
Yeah. So how do you find people who can do functional programming?
It's interesting. When I started CodeScene in 2015, I met an investor early on. Mm-hmm. I met multiple investors. But one investor I spoke to asked me that, hey, we're using this really odd, strange language that no one has ever heard about. If you would use Java, you can hire 10 people tomorrow.
Yes.
The thing is, I don't necessarily want 10 people, right? So it turns out that Clojure is, not only does it allow each person to kind of do more than what we could have done, and with the larger team, you also have all the coordination aspects. So as long as you can avoid it, it's a win. And I found that Clojure is actually like on a hiring magnet, right? The people who know Clojure, they really, really want to work with Clojure, because the drawback of learning Clojure and or any Lisp in general is that you never want to go back to what you used before, right? It's a one-way street. So we never had that problem.
Okay.
And well, I think it's also kind of a good hiring filter, because if you know Clojure, then you are most likely to learn it in your spare time, and means you're really, really interested in this stuff.
Yeah, yeah. Also, Clojure is getting a great rep. A lot of very good names are recommending it at conferences left and right as the new thing. Although it's dynamically typed, and I famously am not a fan of dynamically typed languages. Coming from a type theory background, it seems very difficult to. It seems you need a lot of discipline. And if there's something that I'm not trusting people with, it is having discipline. Again, especially also because I exactly try to build systems where humans' default behavior is the right thing that I want, actually. Also on their worst days, and I would find people would tend to skip on stuff like using dynamic types and just I didn't quite get the tests for this and stuff. Do I test for a code scene?
Yes, we have tests on multiple levels. And I mean, it's vital no matter what programming language you use. I'm a big fan of things like test-driven development. Mm-hmm. We have integration tests, and then we have a bunch of end-to-end tests that runs on the whole thing that kind of complement each other. But I think for a dynamical type language, I could never imagine doing that without having tests. Mm. I don't know how we should hold it together.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I would expect that in a dynamic type language, testing is way, way important, because you need something to keep the code in place, right, when it starts drifting, which is where I would usually use types or even proofs if I'm being academic.
Yeah.
But it seems very, very difficult to get sort of IntelliSense and all these different refactorings where I want to move stuff and just check that it still works without having to change the tests, which is what I usually find also. You must have also met the problem of, you know, a lot of people end up, even if they write tests, that don't support the code, support refactoring. They actually hinder it because they're too tightly coupled to the structure.
Yeah, I've seen that so many times. I mean, in fact, some of the worst technical debt that I've ever seen has been an automated test code. Mm-hmm. And I think we, as developers, we make some kind of mental distinction between application code, which we know is important, keep it clean, nice and tidy. Then we have the test code where, frankly, we're happy if we get time to write any of it at all.
Yeah.
And I think it's really dangerous. And I had so many arguments with people telling me that it's just test code. But it's never just test code, because if a test lacks in quality, they will hold back your overall efforts. And the example you give is really good. My tests are supported to simplify and even make refactoring possible, right? And if the tests are extremely tightly tied to the implementation, then they're actually hindering you. Mm-hmm. And there's very little using having a test that breaks the moment you change some internal detail in your code.
Yeah. I think we could talk about testing for hours, I can feel, because my advice would always be, if your tests are too complicated, you should refactor the code so that it's easier to test.
Yes.
That makes the tests usually... I always attack the code, and I would never refactor the test. But I think we're about out of time, more or less. It's been a pleasure talking to you, Adam. Thank you very much.
Really nice to meet you, and thanks a lot for that wonderful talk today.